Attentive audience members, thank you for being there with us. We'll start off with our instruction course on what after residency, fellowships and other options beyond residency. Our first speaker is you, Devendra, you'll go first. No, sir, in case you have to leave, we can start. Yeah, and if you can. Or Devendra, you want to start? Yeah. So Devendra will start, then you can second. By then, a little more audience may also come. Our first speaker is Dr. Devendra Venkatramani, who's a practicing retina surgeon who straddles between Navi Mumbai and Pune. He's fellowship trained at LV Prasad after residency at Shankar Netralaya, and is one of the few people who I know who've done the FRCS Edinburgh, Glasgow, as well as the MRCS Edinburgh. So he's extremely well qualified to give this talk on FRCS cracking the code.
Thank you, Akshay, for that kind introduction. And I'll be sharing a little bit about what I feel are the important points for anybody who is interested in giving these examinations and taking it on from there. So to begin with, what are the Royal Colleges? Basically, these are institutions that have been given a decree by the sovereign of the United Kingdom. They don't have any special rights and privileges against other colleges, but over the years they've become very famous as institutions of learning and education. And even today, these are the three colleges in the UK which govern all of ophthalmic training in the UK. And India being a colony of the UK, we still are very much in awe of all things British. So we have a little bit of this colonial baggage to carry. But I think there are a lot of advantages to it. The oldest of these is the Royal College of Surgeons of Edinburgh. And that was established in 1505. It was actually a guild of the barber surgeons. You may know that the surgeons are actually originally were the barbers, and they used to take off little warts and incise abscesses and boils. And in 1505, they formed their own guild of barber surgeons in Edinburgh. So that gives Edinburgh the privilege of being the oldest established Royal College in ophthalmology. And so obviously Edinburgh and Scotland and Glasgow are in Scotland, which is still technically part of the United Kingdom. And the Royal College of Ophthalmologists, which is the most recent to be established, only about 30 years ago, is based in London. The Glasgow College, we'll first talk about FRCS Glasgow because probably that's the examination that most people in India are familiar with. Like I mentioned, it's in Scotland, but it also has a dubious distinction of being the heart attack capital of Europe. Partly that's because they deep fry everything, and that's a fried Mars bar. Mars chocolate, they wrap it in batter and deep fry it, and that's one of their local delicacies. I couldn't go beyond the first spoon. It was atrocious. But these are a few pictures of the convocation, and it's held in a very grand style with Harry Potter like gowns and a lot of pomp and pageantry. And it's a college that has multiple specialities. It's the Royal College of Physicians and Surgeons of Glasgow, but they also have faculties of podiatry, dentistry. So it's rather a large college by itself. Coming to the examination, there are three parts. The first part is the basic sciences and optics part. It's basically just a MCQ test. There's no negative marking. The second part is the clinical sciences, which again comprises of two sections, the MCQ test, which you write on another day, and the written paper, which is a separate examination, which has three questions on ophthalmology, and there's one question on general medicine, which is essentially a medical emergency. This paper is a two-hour paper, so you have roughly about half an hour per question, but the question on general medicine has to be passed independently. If you pass the three questions on ophthalmology but fail in the question on the medical emergency, you fail this section of the examination. So they give a lot of weightage to this aspect of medical emergencies, as they should. The part three is again divided into two subparts. There's the structured oral examination, which covers ophthalmic medicine, ophthalmic surgery and pathology, and general medicine and neurology. And then the second part is the clinical examination, where you have to examine patients, and that covers the anterior segment, the posterior segment, neuro-ophthalmology and ocular motility, and oculoplastic and limb disorders. I'll come to a little bit of detail in these a little later. When are you eligible? So for part one, you basically have to finish your MBBS and internship. After that, any time you can do part one. You don't have to demonstrate having trained in ophthalmology for n number of months or years to appear for part one. However, for part two, you should have at least 5 years of post-qualification, that is post-MBBS training, of which 4.5 years should be in ophthalmology. And in part three, essentially, you have to have completed parts one and two successfully. How much does it cost? That's quite an important question, because these are expensive examinations, and these are figures from last year. So if we total up the, you know, the minimum amount that you would spend giving all three parts of the FRCS Glasgow examination is roughly a little more than 2 lakh rupees. So that is some real cause for headache and concern. Something that you should be aware of before you start giving the first part and then realize that, you know, you are running out of funds to go ahead. They also are very generous. They say you have a maximum of 6 attempts for each part. But I think before that, all of us will be quite old and infirm, and we probably also would be bankrupt. So I don't think anybody would reach 6th attempt to give each part. This is the website where you get all the additional details and their guidelines, their fees, their dates of examination. So anybody who's interested should definitely access that website and go through that. Coming to the Edinburgh examination. Now, this is slightly different. It's a different college, so they have different philosophies. In part A, you have basic sciences, optics, ophthalmic investigative techniques, and there is something called generic issues of medical practice, in which they cover epidemiology, audit, something we are really not exposed to in India, good medical practice, which is defined by the GMC, and medical emergencies, and basic principles of ophthalmic surgery. This is also an MCQ examination. Part B is divided into three parts, and this is directly, you know, a practical examination, so you don't have any theory paper here. The first section is oral examination, where you have table vivas in four tables, and in that, what is different is principles of good medical practice, where once again you have to discuss on medical audit, ethics, other aspects of actual practice. Again, something that we are woefully lacking in training in India. The OSCE section is covers anterior segment, posterior segment, neuro-ophthalmology and medicine. And these are patients that you have to examine in each of these sections. And on the third day, you have to do a clinical refraction for half an hour, in which you have to obviously check vision, you have to do retinoscopy, and you have to do a subjective refraction, duochrome test, binocular balancing, all within half an hour. And your values have to be roughly close to what the patient is wearing, and you're graded on the basis of that. Part C is a whole different ball game, which I have not yet reached, but this examination unfortunately is only available in Edinburgh. You can't do this in India or in the Middle East like other parts. This has an extended matching question, that's a theory paper. There are 8 tables of oral examinations of 20 minutes each. In one of these, you have to discuss the documents that you have already submitted before, which includes a personal surgical outcome record, in which they want to see your results of 100 cataract surgeries, 10 squint surgeries, 10 filtering and glaucoma surgeries, 3 lid surgeries. So they have a format of training, and you need to get that assessed or filled in by your institute that you trained from, and you have to submit that data and your results of that. Additionally, you should have a research report, which should have been a published report, and a formal audit. And basically, an audit means that it has to affect patient care. So there are some guidelines as to what type of audit you need to do. And then you go, when you go for the examination, they'll discuss all of these with you, and you know, you get graded on that as well. And there's a third part again, which is examination of patients. So it's a very exhaustive and comprehensive examination, and probably that's why I have not summoned up the courage to go ahead with it. This is the website for the Edinburgh College, so you can get more details on that. There's something called the modified Angoff technique, which is something we are not again used to in India, but it's useful to know that these examinations don't have negative marking and they don't have a fixed pass mark for all examinations, which means that like in India, if you don't score above 50%, you fail. It's not like that. Here, the examination, each paper is graded on the basis of its difficulty. So if the examiners feel this is a difficult paper, the pass mark is lowered. And if it's an easy paper, the pass percentage, is raised. So depending on that, it's very specific to the paper that you solve. So, you know, you have to basically exceed that cutoff for that particular paper, which is a good thing, I think. I mean, it makes it more objective. Coming to how do you prepare for these examinations, if the chairperson is okay, I'll probably overshoot the time because we have some time. So preparing for the examination in part one, the optics part, these are the basically the recommended reading, which is what I read. And I think the textbook by Elkington is really good and very, it's short and it's sweet and it really covers basic optics in a very nice way. For those who want a little more depth, the textbook by A.K. Khurana is also excellent, especially the section on contact lenses, which is really in-depth. With regard to basic sciences, John Ferris is an author who has written this book on MCQs, and it's really nice because it's in the form of a guide. So you have the questions and then you have detailed answers as to why the particular option is correct and why the other options are wrong. Once again, John Forrester is a very exhaustive textbook on anatomy and physiology with relation to ophthalmology. And incidentally, John Forrester was awarded the honorary FRCS at the same convocation that we attended. For part two, it's just clinical ophthalmology. So the MS or DNB syllabus is more than enough. You don't really have to go through anything more than that. This is an MCQ book by Jeffrey Lampkin, and it's very exhaustive and it's also very difficult, I would say. The examination is not as difficult as the questions in this book. So if you don't do too well while reading this book or attempting these questions, you don't have to worry. You will still do well in the examination. Strongly recommended is the Oxford Handbook of Clinical Medicine, which is a lovely, short, concise book. It's not all that short, but the section that you need to read for the examination is very short. It's the last 40 pages of this book, which is nicely, it has a red margin demonstrating that it's just emergency medicine. And these are few of the clinical situations that one has to be conversant with. I would strongly recommend knowing the dosages of drugs, especially antiarrhythmics and management of status epilepticus, etc. These are important medical emergencies, and obviously something that we can encounter in clinical practice. The aim of this part of the examination is to assess the situation, ability to establish a preliminary diagnosis, etc. So one doesn't really have to go into too many details of diagnosis, differential diagnosis and management, but you should definitely get to a working diagnosis and some brief questions about the management. Coming to a few tips. In this type of examination, they have all FRCS examinations, they are very practical, they are very methodical, and they are all assess your approach to a situation. So in a sense, the theory aspect is not even tested in the theory examinations. Nobody's asking you the third most common cause of blindness in age group less than 3 years. That's not important for this examination. But if you don't answer retinoblastoma because it's life-threatening, then that's a serious infraction. So always this examination proceeds from life-threatening to vision-threatening to a cosmetic problem, which is something we probably don't think of when we are preparing for Indian examinations. In the viva and the clinical examination, the viva is basically three tables, 20 minutes each, and these are the subsections. Most of it is very clinical and case-based, so they would give you a printout, a color fundus photograph, a visual field examination, or a slide that you have to start describing and talking about. Not very complicated. And if you are going off track, they will guide you and say, could you think of something along these lines? And in that situation, you have to take the hint and say, yes, sir, you're probably right, and this could be this. So always take the clues that the examiner gives you. It's a very structured examination. Like I said, there are specific questions the examiner is allowed to ask you. He can't ask you anything under the sun. And he also has a model answer key. So if you are varying from that model answer, it is to your detriment. But if you hit those keywords which are in his model answer, you will get those points. There's no scope for interpretation on the part of the examiner that you probably were thinking something else, but luckily you said this, therefore it is you don't get the marks. There's no scope for that. If you've given those words, you get the marks. Like I said, it's always in the form of a clinical situation. Generally, the question proceeds from an easy to a difficult subpart. So the first thing would be, what do you think this patient has, or what is the finding that you can see in this photograph? And once you answer that, then he'll ask you what would be the differential diagnosis, etc. So it builds on the previous answers that you give. And of course, these are the cases that you have to see, and they cover all of ophthalmology in its detail. You spend about 12 minutes at each station, so it's very rapid. It's really like a rapid fire. Two examiners are there for the clinical cases. And on an average, you may see 3 to 4 patients. But the more patients you see, the better. The examiner will stop you if he feels that you are answering well in this particular, you understand this particular clinical situation. He'll immediately move you on to the next patient and give you a chance to answer better and answer more in a different situation. Definitely practice pays. So if you are planning to give this examination, rehearse your answers, rehearse how you would talk about these practical problems. It's always good to have a study buddy who you can discuss your answers with, and you can pretend that one of you is a patient and one of you is the examiner, and start a methodical approach of slit lamp, and even assume, for example, that this patient, suppose you're examining a patient with Fuchs endothelial dystrophy, and you start enumerating the findings that you are imagining while seeing the slit lamp. What are the advantages of these examinations? There are certain tangible benefits. If you clear the FRCS, you do not have to give the PLAB exam for going to the UK, but you can directly then register with the GMC. If you are planning to migrate to the Middle East, there is better remuneration if you have an FRCS degree. And these degrees are accepted as valid degrees in ophthalmology in Singapore and in Hong Kong. So if you are planning to leave the country in these specific areas, yes, they definitely have an advantage over an MS or DNB. If you're planning to give the ICO examination, there's a cross exemption with parts 1 and 2A. Probably a strong reason why a lot of people give the examination is that there's some joy in having accomplished something. There's a sense of achievement, and probably a lot of us are infatuated with the post-nominal initials, that is multiple degrees after our name. We don't probably have to go to the extent of this medicine scholar who has cleared all the examinations one can think of. But it does add to our sense of ego and self-perception. The disadvantages are that it is not a licensing examination, which means that if you clear this examination, it does not mean that tomorrow you can apply and get a job in the UK, or you can get a job. You still have to go through the local regulations and local regulatory body and practices. And of course, they are very expensive examinations, so that goes without saying. We run an FRCS ophthalmology refresher course in Panvel, and anybody who's interested in this examination could definitely attend this. I think it's quite valuable because we have interactive discussions and case-based discussions, and we have patients where you can hone your skills and practice. So anybody who's interested can take down those details. Our course will probably be in the month of August, and the part 3 would be in September in Hyderabad. So I wish all of you who are giving the examinations all the very best, and thank you for this opportunity. Thank you to the chief instructor for having me here.
Thank you, Devendra. If quickly you have a couple of questions. Actually, I had a couple of questions. You said that the FRCS does get you registered into the GMC, and also you know, allows you to is considered a valid degree in a few Commonwealth countries. Is that for both the FRCS as in Edinburgh as well as Glasgow? Or?
Yes. So it doesn't give you direct GMC registration. You still have to actually register with the GMC, which is the governing body for all medical doctors in the UK. But the PLAB examination, which we are familiar with from our UG days, and all of those who wanted to go to the UK would have to write the PLAB, which basically means that you don't have to learn anatomy, I mean general anatomy, general physiology, microbiology, everything all over again. So if you are now an ophthalmologist and you want to avoid first and second and third year MBBS subjects, then the FRCS examination is a good way to go. You could not do the examination and give the PLAB also, but having an FRCS degree probably gives you more weightage when you apply for a job in the UK.
And also, since the FRCS, the college is so liberal in allowing six attempts, economically for us, do we have to pay for every attempt, or one attempt allows us to?
Yeah, that's a very good question. They are a little generous in that you don't have to give at least all the parts, only the part or the subsection that you do not clear, you can appear only for that. So for example, in a particular viva, you don't clear the oculoplasty section, you can only then appear for the oculoplasty section. The problem is that the fee is, although it's not the same as the first attempt, for example, the first attempt is £1,250, £1,250. If you resit even one part, you still end up paying £850. So it's still very expensive.
Quite a pound of flesh.
Pound of flesh, yeah, good one, yeah.
Okay.
I will not discourage people from giving FRCS, but for your information, FRCS in Middle East countries does not give you better remuneration than MD and MS exam. Now FRCS, supposing you are just an MBBS and FRCS, you come entire three qualifications in UAE. Yeah. If you are an MD and MS, you come with tier two qualification. You get better, you are more held than MS with or without MS with FRCS. Okay. And even if you have an MS with FRCS, your remuneration still remains same because you're still at the post of a specialist only, not a consultant. For a consultant, you need to have CCST from UK with at least 7 to 8 years of experience. Then only they consider, because see, now there are, as people are moving around with MDMS, now there are people moving around with FRCS everywhere. And I think the Middle East countries have realized that over a period of time. So it does not give you a better remuneration. But yes, if you want to move to UK, to get GMC registration to do a fellowship or something, it's a way.
Well, that's applicable only to the UAE, but in Oman and in Saudi, there is still weightage for FRCS. And the pay scale does differ considerably if you have an FRCS in Oman at least.
Thank you. I think our next speaker is Dr. Krishna Prasad. He is a man who wears multiple hats in different spheres, in ophthalmology and in education. Trained from the RPC, and he's currently at MM Joshi, and he practices glaucoma, pediatric ophthalmology, and oculoplasty, and is one of the leading ophthalmology educators in on the scene today.
Yeah. Good morning, and I really congratulate all the people who have come in on the last day at this hour. And this talk basically is about, if you are a resident, if you are doing a post-graduation ophthalmology, or if you are a fellowship pursuing specialization in a particular subspecialty, like how do we actually maximize our opportunities? So you have a limited time, you are fixed to a particular institution, so your resources are limited and actually confined. But how do you actually get the best out of your present situation? Because we do find many of the, at least the postgraduates, complaining that their institution is not good enough, they don't have enough infrastructure, the opportunities are limited, they always compare themselves with other institutions of repute or their neighborhood or their friends, that they are getting more, they are learning more. But what exactly that actually goes wrong? Can we do something to maximize the output from the kind of training that we can get from whatever place that we are in? So there is no too many hard facts. This is just a sort of a food for thought, and maybe something that everybody else actually know already. So I would probably tell this is the best time that you have. You have to really enjoy your life. At the same time, you know, make the best use of your present situation. Because once you get into practice, Okay, you have your own restrictions and your own kind of limitations and goals to pursue. So the learning takes a back seat. So this is the best time that you can actually devote to really get into this world of ophthalmology. And I would rather, you know, say that the triad of success, okay, in any in life, in any particular pursuit is basically you need to have the knowledge, you need to have the skills, and you need to have the right kind of attitude. See, knowledge basically you get from outside. The skills you learn by your mentors or by looking at somebody, or there are different kinds of skill sets that you need to acquire. And obviously, attitude is something very innate. That is something nobody can actually change. It is something what you are born with. So these are the three things that we'll actually harp upon. And let me start with the knowledge. Present day knowledge, of course, is I just recently I chanced upon 1,900 digital ophthalmology textbooks. It is a treasure, you know, beyond imagination. In fact, I gave it to my postgraduates. I gave them the hard disk. It has around 49 GB of 1,900 brand new editions of ophthalmology textbooks, which was not even named and segregated. I just gave it to them. I thought everybody will jump at it and copy into their laptops. I asked, you know, I just forgot about it. I asked after a week later. Nobody had actually copied it in their laptops. So this is probably a sort of a poverty among plenty. We have so much of information from all corners, especially the e-resource, the digital format of information. Okay, I still remember our residency days. We used to get into those dusty corridors of National Medical Library, NML, next to Ames, where we would really go in, get up from, cupboard, dusty cupboard, which nobody had entered for years together, trying to search a particular article. Okay, it was not available online anyway, most of them. So, but presently, this is probably an age where you can really, you know, exploit this particular situation. And also, it has become more difficult because there's so much of knowledge in every subspecialty and you have too short a time. The kind of residency that you have, the kind of fellowship period you have is too short to imbibe so much of, you know, ocean of knowledge. But what is the sole purpose of getting the knowledge? Like basically, is it that you want to pass an exam? Or you just want to, basically the patient who sits in front of you tomorrow is the examiner. That is the exam of your life, of your professional life. That is the main reason. So you need to really finally, but I find that still, even then, having said this, still our exam, our course for exam going postgraduate runs full house because still we need to pass the exam. But having said that, it's important that you really keep that big picture in mind and try to basically look at when you are there, whether this knowledge is useful or is it redundant. And obviously you have so much of online resource. Presently there is, knowledge is everywhere. You just need to get the right kind of guidance. I think Dr. Santosh Honawar always gives a talk on the resources, the e-resources, and you need to just chance upon, in fact, these things. There are so many websites, so many e-books, textbooks available today, and probably this particular knowledge has to be relevant and contemporary. See, still there are, you read the exam like how to put a limbal ring. Okay, you still find out like the age old techniques, what the Duke Elder's textbook with due regards to the Duke Elder textbook. It has to be relevant and it has to be contemporary. We need to really know what is actually doable, what is useful for the patient. Okay, is it usable knowledge? Is it that we can really put it into practice? Does it make our practice better or the treatment better is something that you need to know. Just not learn anything and everything that is in the textbook. And obviously, in these meetings actually help like this, like you need to interact with the stalwart. Like you may be doing something for ages when you meet somebody who is a stalwart, you know, who is a key opinion leader. You just talk to them, sir, what is the current practice? That can completely change your outlook. You need to make use of meetings like this, personal communications, or talk to them, befriend them, and just find out what is contemporary, what they are doing, so that you know the cutting edge technology, so that you are at the, you know, best advantage of gaining the knowledge. And continuous upgradation. So this is very important for postgraduates. Okay, every year things change. You need to know what is actually presently what we are doing today. And this is a very important thing for me as a postgraduate teacher. I'm a little traditional, I teach these things, soft skills, blackboard teaching. I am still into that. I still find that we need to reinvent our old traditional methods. And these are the skills that a postgraduate has to really do his own volitional effort to really get into each one of these grooves. Like you have observational skill. I put it on the top of surgical. See, normally skills means people only talk of surgical skills in post-graduation. But I put observational skills first in the order of importance, then the clinical diagnostic skills, communication skills, and also skills to pass the exam. That is also a very important practical thing. And this is something very important. Who is your role model? Obviously, in the place where you work or you get trained, you may not have the best of the role models, but you can always look around and try to get. See, when you see somebody, always, if somebody is very bad, at least you learn how you should not be. And if somebody is very good, you can at least learn, you can emulate them. So you should kind of, you know, look at the role models, look up to them, and just see what they do. It's very important that, I call it a reverse O6. There's a consultant in one of our branches who's an excellent communicator. His OPD skills are, you know, beyond imagination. Always by rotation, post a postgraduate to sit behind him in the corner of a room and just watch him. Like how he talks to a child, how he talks to an old man, how he takes care of a post-op counseling. The way he opens up, how he breaks the ice, how he talks is something that no textbook can teach. So you just have to observe him and just, you know, copy paste in the beginning. Later you can probably customize your own technique. This is your OPD skills, your observational skills probably come the most, and you need to observe in the operation theater. Basically, most of our postgrads are busy giving a block or doing a biometry. Even though they have time, they are into their WhatsApp or doing something else, and they don't really look at the monitor that is. So what is there, we normally lose importance of that. See, many times we remember when we start getting into surgical practice, then we understand the small tips that we can absorb. So even today, I take an outing sometimes to go to different operation theaters of stalwart and watch, because there is some small tips that you can get into our practice. So that is, in the theater, if we have a facility to observe, you know, surgeries either to the observer eyepiece or on the monitors, you should never miss this opportunity, because the same situation when you come across in your future, you should be able to manage that. And surgical skills, of course, most of the postgraduates and fellows do take some time to really gel into the fellowship and start late. I think especially somebody who is into ophthalmology, they should pick their microsurgical dexterity, hand-eye coordination as early as possible. Like if you got a permission to stay longer in the OT, stay beyond the operation theater list and put in and go under a microscope and start learning your hand-eye coordination. And you know, you should use an optimum wet lab training. If you have a wet lab, you should use it optimally. You should be spending your night soil there and try to do as many wet lab as possible, because the moment you pick it up, see, it's always like that. Somebody who's good in surgery will get more chances, because your mentor also wants to debulk his work. So you try to become surgically proficient as early as possible to exploit the situation. It is possible, but we don't really, the postgrads really don't do that, especially the fellows. Well, there are constraints. There are institutions where the surgical training is not adequate. There are no microscopes. The microscope is only one which only the consultant allowed to use. So there's a medical college in Maharashtra where they did this innovative thing. See, presently an Appasamy microscope or a similar kind costs around 2 lakhs. The present day postgraduates get around 40,000 or 35 to 40,000 per month. So what they chipped in is everybody put in like a bought shares. Like there were 20 postgraduates, like each of them put 10,000. It's like a share. So they bought a microscope, okay? And that is their microscope. Of course, can be used by the department, but it was basically that now the HOD cannot say that we have only one microscope, you spoil it, what next? So now they kept on training themselves under that, because there were cases no microscope, so they filled that gap. And the next set of postgraduates, okay, they bought those shares. So they got back that 10,000 and went back with the degree. So every time you come in, you chip in that money. And so seeing that, the company actually gave one more microscope. So this is the kind of innovation. See, it's all about your willingness to really change the system if you want. And if you're really, consistent, you know, like if you really want to do, the whole world conspires to get you those things. Okay, that is something, a small example to say. And respect to the tissue is respect to the patient. Okay, we always train on charity patients. This is something, their food for thought, that we always have to look at the patient rights when we're getting training. In surgical skill transfer or training, we always violate the patient rights. Patient's rights for a good vision. We spoil so many eyes, so many people get suboptimal results because of our training. This is something that we need to keep in mind. Because our wet lab systems are not so prevalent in India, okay, we should not forget the fact that we are actually learning on somebody else's eye and his right for good vision. So this is something that we need to learn, and we should not be really, you know, harping on just trying to get more cases and try to probably manage a situation which we are not competent at. So this is something that we need. This will go a long way, okay, and it will come back to 100-fold. And finally, this is probably the cornerstone of your professional success. The way you talk, the success lies in your broadcast area. Okay, you cannot really keep mum be grumpy, not talk and still be successful. Okay, all your lapses in your profession, your surgery and your diagnostic skills can be managed, compensated if you can probably talk it out. And you should watch people, how they talk, you should rehearse, but you should emulate, you should enact, role playing. I think we need some innovation in our teaching, because this is something that we need to observe, because there is no practical or a curriculum in our medical school for communication. Like in UK or elsewhere, or in US, we have never been taught how to talk to the patient, you know, how to break the bad news. Like there was a case that happened in Kerala, like one patient went to take up a case, like one patient of retinitis pigmentosa had just come in, young fellow, for some other reason. And they can admit a new in a government hospital, admit a case just for a case presentation. They admitted him, he had no clue why he was admitted. In the evening, that young resident of first year went to take the case and he asked, what is the problem, why I am admitted? He just said, you have retinitis pigmentosa, what is it? Like, your vision is going to close down, I am going to become blind. Yes, you are going to become blind. Is there any treatment? No treatment. So he just broke it blatantly, you know, right on his face, and just took his case and went back. Next day morning, the patient was not found in the ward. He was found hanging in the bathroom. Like, he had committed suicide because his news was broken so blatantly and absolutely, I mean, being unaware of how, I mean, can be the impact of such a news on the patient. So even though the situation is critical, there is a way to break the bad news. And how to counsel you. It's like we never teach our postgraduate how to counsel a cataract patient. Once they are into practice, they are into all kinds of gimmickry. So you need to have a dry run in your PG, in your fellowship. Like, you just imagine. See, what is very important is the whole concept is about you are a novice, you need to become an expert. So this whole transformation of being a novice to an expert, okay, goes through so many forms in terms of learning how to even communicate, how to prognosticate, how to, you know, tell the bad news. And clinical skills is something that you need to understand. Like, in a situation, you need to spend minimum time and get maximum information. That is about history taking or maybe clinical examination. And exactly the quality and accuracy. Like, if you ask a patient, a student to look at a preoperative cataract, they just directly look at the lens. This patient is for surgery today, just have a look. They don't look at the lid margin. They may miss an STI or an obvious infection at the lid margin. They don't look at the adnexa. They just directly look at the lens nuclear sclerosis. So this is something that we need to have the kind of accuracy, the quality, the kind of comprehensiveness that we need to bring into our, that is going to go a long way. And also this, I'm a big advocate of, you know, trying to bring in the value of empathy in our training. Like, how empathetic you are and how that can change your practice and the kind of gratification you get from your practice. And again, the final thing is that you are novice, you need to become expert. So this is sort of a stepwise approach, and you need to maximize your opportunities. And finally, I tell you, this is the attitude that it is something that you cannot be influenced by others. It is your own, innate, inborn. And the right kind of attitude towards life, to your patients and professional life can completely transform you and get you to the top. So thank you very much.
If anybody has
any questions, I think.
I will speak. Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you so much.
Last minute accommodation from your schedule. I will be speaking next on the ICO exam. So essentially these presentations are the ICO and the FRCS presentations were together initially made by Devendra, and then they were clumped separately. So there would be some overlap. So I'll give a brief overview of the ICO as an organization and the examination in itself. So it basically was founded about 80 odd years ago, and it serves to be one of the bodies that represents all the professional associations of ophthalmologists throughout the world. And it's based in, it's in literally an international organization because it's based in San Francisco, the headquarters, but the examination offices are in London and the fellowship offices are in Munich. And you have to pay the examination fees in Swiss francs. So that's how it works. They have a very exhaustive website which gives all the information available for everything. What they say is that they want to enhance ophthalmic education, improve access and the highest quality eye care in order to serve, preserve, restore, enhance vision. This is straight out of their website. Their goals and strategies are education, eye care delivery, society leadership and organizational development. Yeah, I know what you're thinking. So we'll come to the meat of what the ICO exams are. So ICO exam, it doesn't claim to be, you know, a licensing exam like an MD or an MS that gives you the position to practice, much like the FRCS, but it's a competency exam. If you have cleared the ICO examinations of different levels internationally, then people know that, all right, he has a certain level of competency, at least, or sound knowledge and skills in ophthalmology. And, you know, if you have the postnominal initials of FICO to your name, then they know you are of a certain quality. There are different exams. The foundation exam, which we often don't know about, is primarily meant for medical students. And it can be paid for separately. But if someone wants to be very comprehensive and give every exam, and you register for the basic sciences exam, you can, in addition, give the foundation exam, and then for that it's free. And it can be given prior or during or before your first year, like I said, and it's only 50 francs if you want to give it, appear for it separately. It is considered to be a tool for the preparation of basic sciences examination. The basic science examination is primarily a 2-hour paper. It has 80 MCQs with 4 options and 1 correct answer. There are no negative markings. And this basically is most residents prefer to appear for the FICO basic sciences in their first year because they are slightly more fresh in terms of the subjects that it covers, which are anatomy of the eye, embryology, neuroanatomy, etc., epidemiology and statistics. No matter what stage of your ophthalmology career you are, you never have a clue. So the other part that is usually given alongside with is appeared for alongside with the basic sciences is theoretical optics and refractions and instruments. So this is a 1-hour examination. There are 40 MCQs with 4 options, similar to the basic science, with no negative marks. So essentially you have, on the same day being conducted, the basic sciences and the optics and refraction, and you appear for both of them sitting in the same place. You finish your basic sciences paper and then they hand over the optics and refraction and you finish that and your results come together. But in order to have cleared part one, which is basic sciences and optics and refraction, you have to have passed each of these two segments individually. If not, then you have the option of reappearing for them separately depending on which one you didn't clear at the first time. Once that is done, then after you have cleared your residency, you are eligible for, that is after 3 years in training, you are eligible for a clinical sciences examination. This is a 4-hour paper. 4 hours is usually a duration that most of us are not used to. So I've rarely seen people sit through 4 hours, but at the end of 3 hours, they, you know, 2.5 hours, they're done with their papers and go through. It's 200 MCQs with 4 options. Again, there are no negative markings. This is relatively easier in for people who finished their training, that is in terms of their MD or MS or DNB, because the subjects that are covered in the clinical sciences are very clinical, and they give scenarios, and it's not very very statistical or hardcore theory. It's more of practical. Then finally, the new, this was introduced in 2013, the advanced examination, which is a 3-hour based paper. It has 10 extending type matching type of questions, 75 context setting description, which can be either written, visual or graphical, and each with 4 associated statements which require the single best answer. A positive mark is awarded for each correct answer, but no mark is given for those left incorrectly marked, that is marked incorrectly or left blank. So basically no negative markings, but it's not as straightforward. It's a little bit of application, and there may be some overlap between the options, and you have to choose the one that you feel is most right. So how much does this cost? So if you have to look at it, it's all in Swiss francs, and if you start from the basic sciences, the optics refraction, clinical sciences, and the advanced, so over a period of 3 years, going by yesterday's exchange rate, you would end up spending 2.3 lakhs, which is a lot of money. So again, is it worth it is something we need to ask. Thank you, Devendra, for the idea of the Munch painting. This is a theme that will recur. So preparation for the exam, it essentially is the same thing that you would do for your FRCS exams. The books don't change because the subject doesn't change, and the list of books that have been given, there is on the ICO examination website a list of suggested reading. It's a little surprising that they actually stick to the list of suggested reading right down to the T, because there are these certain questions that are picked out from the books that have been given and directly put into the examination paper without even a change of wording. So then, you know, it's almost like you read this and you will pass. Like Devendra said, A.K. Khurana's practice of optics and refraction is quite exhaustive and useful, as is Elkington. So for optics and refraction, especially for us who've done residency in India, where we don't get that much exposure to optics and refraction, and we end up just knowing the bare bones and skeletons of it, it's a good initiation into how it's supposed to be done. John Ferris and Forrester, has already been covered. These are the ideal books for basic sciences. For clinical sciences, essentially what you have covered in your residency. I personally felt that the Kansky book, having going through your Kansky and Bowling textbook over a couple of times, cover to cover, prepares you reasonably well for the clinical sciences and the advanced sciences. So is it really worth it, or what is the benefit of doing this? So it's just making sure that in your first year, you'll actually read optics and refraction, because you're paying so much money for it. It gives some sort of structure to your 3-year residency program, because in your first year is when you give your basic sciences, optics and refraction. Towards the end of your residency, when you've already read up everything, you've geared up for your theory and your practical examination, and just after that, at possibly the best position in your career, when you will be prepared well enough to appear for an examination that deals with clinical sciences, you can time that exam so that you maximize the knowledge that you've just gained. So that's a little bit of structure, and then possibly when residents get into their fellowship, they can appear for the advanced examination. Benefit, of one of the only good benefits of the ICO exams is that it allows you to apply for an ICO fellowship. Now, ICO very clearly, it's a little ambiguous. The website doesn't say you must have appeared for the exams before you to be eligible for an ICO fellowship, but they say it is preferred or desirable if the candidate has appeared and cleared the ICO examination. So what they're politely telling you is that yes, you should have. It's like Devendra said, clearing your part 1 and 2, that is a basic science, optics refraction and clinical sciences, gives you exemption from the early steps, that is 1A and 2A of FRCS Glasgow. It is another 4-letter F word after your name, and not essentially, but possibly could give you better job opportunities. But like we know, it doesn't allow you to practice. It's not a licensing exam. And if you're looking at it in terms of getting a fellowship abroad, that the ICO fellowship, it is still technically possible to do the fellowships without appearing for the examination. So you don't want to spend 2.5 lakhs to be able to get a grant of a lakh of 6,000 USD for the ICO fellowship. And it is expensive. What about the ICO fellowships? The ICO fellowship recently has undergone a major rehash. There used to be much fewer fellowships, primarily the one-year retina Helmerich fellowship, as well as then the three-month fellowships, which were awarded quite, they had up to 60 fellowships being awarded every year. But from this year onwards, they have changed their structure a little bit. There is the ICO Allergan Research Fellowship. And then there have two new fellowships, which is the three-month fellowship in the diagnosis and therapy of retinoblastoma and a three-month fellowship in pathology and oncology and microbiology, and a six-month fellowship for the diagnosis and therapy of retinoblastoma. So they've really focused a lot on ocular oncology, pathology, and more specifically retinoblastoma. Do you need to take the exams? Like I already said, they are expensive and it is possible. But they recommend that the candidates pass at least one or more of the ICO exams. Prerequisites for almost each and every one of these fellowships is that the candidate should have completed his licensing examination, which is cleared his residency, should be under 40, fluent in English or the native language of the host center if it is a non-English speaking center, and applicants must return to the home country after the training, resume their previous positions and apply the knowledge gained during their fellowship. So that is what they want in terms of a written guarantee from you or from the institute that you are belonging from. So we'll talk in brief about the ICO Allergan Fellowship. It is a pure research fellowship. They have clear set distinctions in terms of which specialities they'll support: glaucoma, neuro-ophthalmology, pediatric ophthalmology, retina, oncology, uveitis, dry eye and cornea. It is for the first time that they have introduced. The deadline, in case you are thinking of applying, is next week. And the results of the application would be declared at the WOC in Barcelona this year. They provide you, the candidate, with 50,000 USD per year. That is for the entire duration of the fellowship. And again, as always, they prefer that the candidate has appeared for the ICO, appeared and cleared the ICO exams beforehand. Now, these are the most popular ones, the three-month fellowships, which primarily are given out to the developing countries. There are approximately 60 such fellowships being awarded every year. The prerequisites that I already said earlier do apply. And they have two sessions. They have either the March session or the September session, the deadlines being March 31st and September 30th, which you have to apply. Then there is the three-month ICO Retinoblastoma Fellowship. It primarily is for candidates from India and Iran because the training centers for these are based in India and Iran, which is why candidates from these two countries can also apply. It's a three-month fellowship which gives the candidate 6,000 USD to spend. It doesn't have clearly delineate whether it's a research or a hands-on based fellowship. But that is probably likely to differ from center to center, and they have the same deadlines of March and September like the three-month fellowship. They also have the pathology, oncology and microbiology fellowship, which has four predetermined centers. That is one in Denmark, one in UK, US and in India. And unlike the other fellowships here, candidates who have applied for the three-month fellowship earlier can also apply again for this. The same two deadlines remain, with the same amount of stipend being offered to the trainees. However, once rejected, you cannot reapply subsequently. Your case is deemed to be closed. And then they have the six-month fellowship, which is primarily conducted. The centers that offer hosting candidates are based in India, Iran, China, Mexico, and Jordan. They are for a duration of 6 months. Now here, what they have considered is that the cost of living in these countries is not high enough to justify a higher stipend than 6,000 USD for the 6 months. So they have reduced the funding available for this. The two deadlines again remain 31st of March and 30th of September. Now, the ICO Retina Research Fellowship, the Helmerich Fellowship, is a one-year fellowship. They award $33,000 for 1 year to cover everything. The applicant must be accepted for ophthalmology super subspecialty fellowship 1 year in duration at an advanced ophthalmology center prior to applying for this. So in this case, the onus for securing the fellowship lies on you. In all the other fellowships, you have to apply to the ICO. They'll help you in procuring your host center. They'll be the medium through which you can interact with the host center and then facilitate that. But in this case, it's your job to apply, and with that application, then you come to the ICO and say, hey, I'm going to go get a fellowship and I'm going to come back and practice. Can you help me fund me? And then they say, okay, we'll do that. And that's what they do. They also have the Fred Hollows Foundation 1 year subspecialty, which gives $24,000. Two fellowships are awarded every year. This is primarily for people in training hospitals who are in training positions, who also, again, like here, have to apply for their own fellowship, secure it, and then come back to the ICO and ask if they can be funded, and they review each applicant case by case. There used to be the ICO SARC 1 year fellowship, however, this is no longer offered by the ICO, which was basically a 6 month, a 1 year fellowship, which could be either structured as 363 or 363 3 months at different centers. Anyway, that's not needed. So a lot of residents or trainees want to know, when should you apply for a fellowship and what is the ideal time you should go abroad? Is it best to complete a fellowship in India and then go abroad to hone your skills? Or after, before a fellowship here, should you do that? Ideally, it's best if a candidate completes a fellowship in the specialty of his choice here in India or wherever he wants to beforehand, before applying for the ICO fellowship, because 3 months then is ideal for you to figure out what you can learn, what you want to learn, and focus only on that in that short duration, rather than being a fresh ophthalmology graduate and then suddenly going there where, it may be a little overwhelming to see a subs already, to get into a subspecialty practice and try to figure out or learn what you want to. Questions that you need to ask yourself is it worth it? Does it add anything to my qualification? And of course, we all know, there are people who see it as just another vacation, which is unfortunate, but also the other question is, should I just apply, is it really worth it going for 1 year? And are research fellowships really useful, or what is the scope of that? And that, I think, the answers to that question we'll get in the subsequent talk. So how does one apply? The process is very transparent and simple. The ICO fellowship website, you go in, register, select a fellowship, the 3 month, 1 year, 9 month fellowship, 6 month fellowship, whichever you want to apply. And then they have an eligibility check where you upload your details, tell them your training level, the years of experience, whether you've appeared or cleared or been rejected earlier. And that is the eligibility check. It takes about 28 to 48 hours for them to get back to you and tell you, yes, you're eligible for this fellowship, you can apply. And then they give you the list of training centers. You can select that and then mail. The communication is initiated from the ICO to the host center. And then the decision is conveyed back to the ICO, who then lets you know within 3 months' time of whether your application is successful or not. Once that is done, the ICO's job is done, and then you have to facilitate a line of communication between the center and yourself to ask, what are the requisites that I need to give, a lot of centers in the US are very clear about what immunization you need to have, what are their health documents, and so. Then once your fellowship has been granted, 1 week before your fellowship starts, you give your account details to the ICO and the funds are transferred, and then that's done. It doesn't end there for the ICO. Once you finish, they expect you to get in touch with them and give them a complete report of how your fellowship was, what did you gain, what did you learn. Important things while choosing a center or the location is, what are the skills that you wish to acquire, and what center are you going? Now, if you're looking at learning something specific, say ocular oncology, and you go to a hospital that doesn't handle retinoblastoma or ocular oncology cases, then the purpose is being defeated. What are you going to be able to do with what you learn? And then can you come back and put that into practice? So a lot of questions that will decide which center and where you can choose your fellowship, and that each candidate is the best person suited to answer that. These are actually questions that are present in the ICO application. So these are not just hypothetical questions made up. So you need to not just ask yourself, but come up with credible answers that the ICO, you know, thinks makes sense, and then will help you approve, and help you in getting through your fellowship application. But what if I want to go to a place that is not in the list of directories? Well, you can then directly approach the ICO, tell them that I want to go to this institute which is not in your directory, and the reason I want to go is because of this, 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 and can you help me establish that? And then if they do, they like you. And if they like what, you know, what you've written, then they may actually go out and help you. Lot of centers in the ICO host directory are across Europe and America. Usually people tend to prefer Europe because the cost of living is a little less, but again, it depends on what you want to go, and if the institute of your choice where you want to train in something that is available only there is in the United States, that's a good place to do. What to write, and you know, these questions that I put up in this slide are, you know, it can be a little bit heavy duty, because you have to literally yarn, you know, spin your answers around trying to come back and put into practice what you've learned and serve the underserved. So you need to do that. Can you apply in multiple places? No. If the first place that you apply, can you apply in multiple places at the same time? No. In case the first center that you apply rejects your application, then you can start over again. But once the application is, the deadline has passed and your application is rejected, you cannot apply again for the ICO 3-month fellowship. So it's to summarize, you know, you have to plan well, choose correctly. The ICO 3-month fellowship can be an eye opener, and which is why I strongly recommend that every trainee who finishes residency should apply. The ICO is increasingly being more generous with awarding that 3-month fellowship. Prepare a timeline so you can plan your career goals accordingly, and it can be a great learning experience with good memories and great skills to acquire. Thank you. And I'd also like to introduce our next speaker, who, well, the most common thing he probably hears during his introduction is that he needs no introduction, but I think it's unfair to the audience to do that. Dr. Rohit Shetty is the vice chairman of Narayan Netralay. He's one of the few people who truly embodies the physician-researcher combination. His area of specialty, as we all know, is corneal and refractive diseases, and he'll be talking to us on basic sciences and research and the opportunities that are there after that. Thank you, sir, for attending our course.
Thank you, Akshay, and thank you, Devendra, for inviting me. I think what I would like to say is, I was just speaking to some of my fellows in the back that, you know, I learned a lot from your talk. The amount of places which can help you with this, with your fellowships. The one of the issues here is, I was telling him, this should have been on the day one or day two. I mean, I think all of you youngsters here, if you like this course, including myself, I think we'll have to write collectively saying that if you accept this course, please do not keep it on a last day when a lot of residents leave back, because many of them have to go back to work. All the people out there who's waiting out there are the ones who are clinicians where they have somebody else to work for. So this has to be on a day one or two. Wonderful course. Thank you for keeping me part of this. So the big question when anybody starts is why do you need to do research, and what do we get out of research? We are more and more getting into this kind of a picture where the normal distribution of your disease does not really exist, and normal distribution of how your outcomes also do not exist. So when you have this normal distribution not happening, it's time we look out. Ashwin is here. He helped me to make this three step. I asked him, what you three-step algorithm, what do you really choose when you want to do anything to do with the research? So he said, get your basic right. Research is not about picking up anything you want. Okay, other day I was in some session where I was looking at people who wanted to do some research, and they had papers like half the research or 75% of the research is done. Okay, I want to do something in vernal Qatar. Okay, let me just do PubMed. Okay, this person has done this, so I'll do the same thing. I told them 99% of them will not even reach even a very low impact journals. You have to challenge your limits. If you want to do on a vernal Qatar, you'll have to see what is not being done. And what is not being done, you'll have to go back and pick up those things. And sometimes you may have to go out of your comfort zone. And when you go out of your comfort zone, that's what you do it when challenge your limit. And all these things definitely add spice. Like you see a lot of youngsters presenting at Rangacharis, you're presenting at various platforms, winning awards. And that's what is important. Everything you do is trying to change the old ways of work. The old ways will not really open new doors. So this is one of been my favorite papers. I put this paper many, many places in this meeting about Ali Tokamani's group. And what he talks about is in the next decade, the new way of medicine is going to be fought on these platforms, genetics, physiological. And what is very interesting here is this behavioral tracking, which means psychometric analysis. Virtually, he just gives you a very broad perspective. It's not dealing with any branch of medicine as such. So what he says is every patient has got a baseline, and these baselines are all your genetics, what you do, how you do, how well you take care of yourself. And it's a deviation from your baseline, and then the disease is to be looked at. For example, it could be diabetic retinopathy, it could be cornea, ulcers, everything. So research is today, we are just getting ready to get ready to the next level. And we are 100% sure what is today's, when 10 years, we'll have only few people sitting down here and making notes, and half the crowd or 90% of the crowd will be in OPL or cataract. I think the day will come and a lot of people will come here because that will come to your clinics. And this is what he says, this will come to your clinic very shortly. And if you're not ready for it, it's not going to work. So what has been our philosophy? Like each person, when you start doing research, you have to have a very clear philosophy of why you want to do it, whether for money. Money is not going to be there. You're going to lose a lot of money initially. Then once we start getting grants, is a different question. So curiosity leads to question, question leads to answers, answers leads to when you get an answer, it becomes translation research, and that becomes to your clinics. And that's how it works, and that's how most of the research lab in this world works. So there are different areas of work. I'm not looking at clinical research. Clinical research is there, you know, your good work, your new instruments, your new surgeries. Yesterday we had innovations. A lot of people spoke about the new ways of doing, trying to treat the same conditions. But all this is going to be there, like genetics, predicting markers, biomarkers, fluids. So when you're looking at a space, these are all the space which you can look at. So I again put this slide quite often, as when somebody says it's smooth as butter, a scientist would say at what temperature, and that is the real way of how a scientist should work. One of the prerequisites is you should have a good team. If you don't have one, you build one over time, or if you see that you can't build one, work with somebody who has that team. Like Akshay mentioned in a very nice way, he said that you have to first find out with whom you want to work and how you want, which place you want to apply for. So for example, if your interest is not research, don't join an institute where there's only research. And if your interest is surgery, you have to find a place. There's nothing called I'll adjust. There's nothing called adjust, because you'll be an odd man out. Once you're an odd man out, I think it's going to be a disaster. And these people, because you need somebody to ask questions, you need also somebody to answer the questions for you. Unless you don't have the right people, if you don't mingle with the right set of people, it's going to be a disaster, even for us or even for you. So if you have a question, whether it's your resident level or a fellowship, wherever, you need those kind of people. So this is a small video of what we do in our practice. There are ideas every day, but they disappear at the end of the day because you're tired and your day has been busy. and you don't contribute anything to science. But what you should do is, if you want to really be a serious researcher, that idea should never leave you. It should be curious. Every single patient is a translation work. And that ideas, and then you start looking at how. And this has been our model. I mean, you can create any models you want. In our model, we always try to bring the clinic and the science together. So our ideas were always a combination of both sides. So what we started doing with one is we started mingling with people who are not the same as you are. And we do not discard this. We've been talking about it for a long time. And a lot of new centers now have started biorepositories. That is a good way today. At least I've seen five places last year who have started looking at this seriously. Clinics I'm talking about. Dr. Manish, Dr. Aditya Kelkar, and all of them have gone into this because I'm sure at some point of time they'll all be able to do all this from their own end. And once you get in there, there's a lot of my own residents, fellows in the past who have to spend, at least if they're keen, they have to spend at least 2 weeks training. And there are some of them are here. Some of them who wanted to do imaging, they also spend some time with the imaging experts. And this is how you create new drugs, innovation, biomarkers. And we have come out with a lot of new patents also on this. So how do you translate what you get, all this from an idea, from a patient care, the model, experiment, everything? It goes step by step. And then there's a simple thing. We were ridiculed a lot that in India, everybody has vitamin D. So what is a big deal? So the first thing in any research is you have to be ready to accept a lot of being shunned at, ridiculed, because nobody wants to see your study. If the same study is done in some other fancy institutes outside India, you probably would get a better respect. Then you can either get out of it and be in your comfort zone or keep publishing. We have published probably the largest series of close to 14 papers in good impact journals from IOVS, TVST to everywhere, including BJO, on vitamin D. And then the world starts looking at you. So each disease you have to question. And each to question, it takes a lot of time. But the pleasure you get when your work is cited, when your work becomes a part of a routine clinical practice, is phenomenal. And when it becomes translational, when somebody says that, okay, well, you know, because of your work, some big company, pharma company internationally comes up and says, well, you know, we believe in your work, now we want to come out with the drug. And that is a true place of sciences. Sometimes you have to question your definition. This was the paper which kickstarted my PhD, where we questioned that it is KSE is not an inflammatory, non-inflammatory disease. And we published a big series of cases. And finally, many, many test books and many, many papers now remove the word non-inflammatory to inflammatory. So in a small way, you're playing a role. And the journey goes on. This is a paper, unfortunately, did not come to the liking of the judges. It did not get anywhere. But it has got a full paper at ARVO. Sometimes your work never gets appreciated in your own center because people think that it's not going to happen. What we did was we questioned how does atropine help in a myope? A simple question. And then we started looking at dopamine in the tears. And dopamine in the tears and correlation with axial length growth in a child and how atropine works has never been done anywhere in the world. So what does it mean that tomorrow, if somebody takes up that area of interest, dopamine testing, which is quite easy, in the tears could be a biomarker for whether your child will have an axial length increase or it's just stable, because dopamine holds the axial length from increasing. A small things. Then there are responders, non-responders for any drug. And this is, again, Ashwin's slide he made some time back about each. If you have a biomarker and the biomarkers are from tears or from your vitreous or from your aqueous, we can pick up I just put some names here, XYZ. These are all, just imagine some cytokines, and you can find which one of them actually drives to get into this. And this is the future, and not the future now. The present thing is all about giving drugs and multiple drugs, and we just knock it off. But the future is about finding biomarkers and anything. And tears, according to me, in the next 6 or 7 years will be exactly the same way as how we do the blood. A non-invasive simple test, not me, including big companies who make big machines like Alcon, Zeiss, and all those people, are all coming out with kits to measure all this because they see a huge potential. It's like Novo Nordisk came out with the glucometer and then insulin sales doubled. That's exactly what is going to happen in the future. So finally, what we are trying to combine is, if you look at an eye or if you look at any research, it has to be genome based, it has to have a genetic component, it has to be a cell based, because what gene does, the cell follows. It's a master. And finally, ophthalmology is one place where you have a huge bunch of mathematical algorithms for everything. The flow, velocity, like every machine is filled. Even only if you connect all of them, only then you probably get a true picture. So this is a very ambitious project. It will take a long time. When we want to, we call it the big prediction. We want to look at all of them in diseases like keratoconus, diabetic retinopathies, wherever where we need to predict. And hopefully, you need a big data for it. Hopefully, you can always dream. Hopefully, we combine everything and bring it into the clinical picture. And then, this is how a lot of Google-based AI is now look at. So, to sum up, I've been very fortunate to have fantastic young clinicians who work with me, who had the same driving force to do something different. Some of them are here, and we have a fantastic team, a bunch of mathematicians, physicists, run headed by Dr. Abhijit Sinha Roy, who was heading the department of Cleveland, and close to around 20 odd PhDs who work in the lab, who help me to keep asking questions. So lack of adequate facilities and rapid implementations is only in your mind. If you take that out of your mind, I think this is a complete domain out there. If you have 2 minutes, I have two clinicians here. One is Ashwin, who took up a path of being the clinician PhD. He finishes it this year. He got married. His wife is also here. So he got deviated from his PhD a little bit. So this year, I think he's going to finish. He's one of the few clinician PhDs from the country who joined as a clinician fellow PhD. He and Natasha both. She's also in this process. So if you can just give us 1 minute of this, because it is important. That's why I thought I'll just spend a few minutes with them, because this is a true journey. What I mentioned, and Dr. Pooja and Shruti, both of them are here, and they can also just say sing, because she worked on cell biology and she worked on imaging, and Ashwin worked more on the mathematical point of view. So there are three people who worked on all the three components, what I just mentioned here, so they can just give an insight into it. Just take quickly.
Good morning, everybody. So about 4 years back, I first met Rohit sir at a conference in Hyderabad. And I told him I wanted to do something different. And he said, I have a machine called retinal oximetry. Will you come and work on it? And it was a very different kind of an interview that was there. But the journey after that has been extremely interesting, because I got to work on a machine that is probably the only one in the country at this point. There are a few more reports from other places, but this was the only machine. And we have imaged more than 3,000 different patients for more than about 10-15 different diseases. And it feels great to be able to publish the first nominated database of the country, to be doing work that even the leaders all over the world, then they kind of cite your papers and things like that. So, and this was along with a routine PhD. So the last 4 years have been...
So basically what he's trying to say is, just because you're doing research does not mean that you can't operate. It's a big barrier in the country. A lot of our people, I think many places in the world, it's... In India, we cannot have 3 years research and 3 years fellowship. That will become is impossible. So what we have to do is, what we have to inculcate is that you have to somehow see that India should have a different way of doing it, because we are, like all of you do research, all of you work on different projects. But I think all three of us don't have the luxury of taking 2 days off in a week and writing a paper, including myself. We have to do it on job, like you finish your work. And so if you're not ready to take it up, it just does not work that way. So basically what Ashwin was trying to say is that you can be a clinician, you can be a researcher, you can do your work, and you can still finish everything in 2 or 3 years' time. Maybe he was a little late because he was other things to look at, but you can actually 2.5-3 years is what is required. Thank you, Ashwin.
Thank you, sir.
Any questions?
More than a question, I think it's a comment that this is the first time we're seeing this talk, so you know it's a lot of learning for us as well. And I think this should be if we were to repeat the course, this should be a permanent fixture at our talks. Yeah, like you said, we have to push for a day one.
You have to push for a bigger slot at the biggest time.
Yeah, and especially because, you know, when we say what after residency, I don't think anybody thinks research. Let's be honest. I mean, what after residency, we think of FRCS, we think of fellowship, subspecialty, we think of career counseling. But research as a career and the combination of research plus clinical work, I don't think anybody seriously looks at that during one's MBBS, during one's post-graduation, and probably after that either. And we know Ashwin from his post-graduation days, so it's really nice to see his journey into something totally different and refreshing.
Like, if you both of them are anterior segment, Dr. Shruti and Pooja. Shruti has just finished, she works now. Pooja is in this year and she's going to finish. One of the biggest challenges they face is when people ask them, do you also operate? See, until unless they're all not fully driven by all this, I think even they would have asked Ashwin also that I have been asked many times that do you operate? And this question is in a nicer way to me, but in a more cruder way to them. Because I keep telling them I have to operate because I have to feed all this. So I have to operate like all of you, unfortunately. But if you want to find time, you will find the time. And I never pushed all of them because it's not like a must that they should be doing this research. It's not that without that research you don't get a case. It's just that, like, I'm taking a lead from your one slide where you spoke about how do you choose with that mirror and this. But if you're choosing a wrong person, and if Ashwin was a wrong fit into this scheme, then he would have been very unhappy with the whole stuff. He'd be very unhappy because he would feel that I've come to a place where I didn't want to come to it. So that one slide, I think, is a fantastic slide to take take home point from this course.
Yeah, I think that's a fantastic point. I mean, I didn't do ultimately the ICO fellowship, but I remember trying to apply for it, and the ICO website, for example, gives you the host directory. So that's the list of all the hospitals and institutions around the world where you can apply for the fellowship. And in that host directory, they tell you who's your host, who's the in charge, what are the facilities available at that hospital, what are their core competencies, what is their teaching schedule, how many grand rounds, how many patients in the OPD, everything. So, you know, the way I approached it was look at who's the host coordinator, look at their publications, if they are a retina person, because I was interested in doing retina. So, if that is a retina person, read up on what are their publications, are they of interest to me, are those fields of interest to me, and then, you know, approach it that way. So you really need to do a lot of research, and you should be happy doing what you want to do ultimately. I think that's the take home.
Thank you. Thank you, Akshay. Thank you, Devo.
So on behalf of all the instructors, I thank all of you for attending. I hope it was of benefit, and thank you to the other instructors as well. Thank you so much.